I hope that my screen is visible.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Shall we go ahead, madam?
Yes, sir, definitely.
Yeah. So, very good morning to all of you. So, I think this is a one-day lecture arranged by St. Joseph College, Devagiri. So myself, Kumar Avel from NIT Calicut. So I'm going to deliver the lecture on applications of artificial intelligence. So before going to the lecture, so let us see the group of audience. So maybe with a different background. So organizer, please help me. What is the group of audience and their background in nutshell?
So we have PG students, academicians. UG students and research scholars, etc., as audience.
Okay, maybe with a different background, right? MSc, BSc, like that, or
academicians are also there.
Okay. So I hope that the topic artificial intelligence may be known to them or completely different.
So we are having PG students, research scholars, and various faculty members from different colleges.
Okay. So have you given any introduction about myself, or shall I have, should I have to introduce myself, or
we have provided a brief introduction, sir.
Okay, madam. Okay, because they have the different background. So I am basically working in electrical engineering. So in fact, I have used this different AI tools in some of the electrical engineering application at NIT Calicut for the past 13 years. In fact, I am teaching the course on artificial intelligence and automations to my PG students. So since you have come across with a different background, so if you feel that I am completely different or maybe not relevant, so please interrupt me at any point of time, because I am here for you. So if you are not convenient, so immediately I have to align my topic according to your interest. So in that aspect, please feel free. I think the audience are there throughout India, right?
Yes, sir.
So preferably English may be a good medium of communication, right?
Of course.
Yeah. So when you talk about introduction to AI, so artificial intelligence, right? Really, it is a hot topic today. In fact, for the past 10 years, everybody is looking into this artificial intelligence, right? So almost artificial intelligence touched upon every field, right? You can take engineering or maybe a medicine or maybe commerce. Almost it is being utilized in various fields. Some of them are shown here. Artificial intelligence. I think you all know this, right? This is vehicle. This vehicle is going to be an electric vehicle. Let me call shortly as EV. So artificial intelligence are used in electric vehicle in various aspects. I think all of you know driverless car, right? Driverless car, the car does not have the driver. So ultimately, highly intelligent mechanism we are going to use in this car. Similarly, when you see home automation, that is here, home automation is really a very good topic today. So lot of tools are being, or lot of devices are being sold in the market. You know, recently the term IoT become very popular, right? So internet of thing, this called IoT. So one such a product, you can see air conditioner. Here I am showing air conditioner, intelligence in air conditioner. Then when you see biomedical, this is a biomedical, right? This is coming under biomedical. So now nobody goes to hospital, right? That too after COVID-19, patients are in home, doctors are in hospital. They are investigating the patient's history through online. If you see, the most commercial product is mobile phone, right? You can easily count the people who are not using cell phone, rather using cell phone. Everybody is having cell phone. Maybe 7 or 8 years back, or maybe 10 years back, if you see in your family, only one cell phone will be there. Otherwise, people use landline. But now if you see the condition, everybody is having individually mobile phone, right? Husband is having a mobile phone, wife is having mobile phone, children have their own mobile phone. Like everybody have their own mobile phone, right? Even sometime they use more mobile phones. Even single person may use 2-3 mobile phone. One husband saved his wife mobile number, like wife 1, wife 2, right? We do not know how to save the number. So ultimately, this artificial intelligence are applied in mobile phone. Many features are there. I think you all know Alexa, right? I do not know how many of you know Alexa. Have you heard about this Alexa?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Whatever you ask, this Alexa will answer, right?
Yeah.
Suppose if you say, you call Kumaravel, So immediately Alexa call me. So that is intelligence, right? So ultimate intelligence is next time when you log in, automatically similar items will come. Suppose you are going to buy a TV, you are searching in Amazon that some LED TV. So next time if you turn on your computer, you will get lot of information about the TV. Activity, so naturally cost come down, naturally cost of the equipment comes down. So the main backbone of our life is this electricity. So all these things are talks about electricity, right? So this AI are used in multidisciplinary manner in the electric network. So one side to promote electricity generation, then distribution, sometime cost of energy, loss reduction, like different field of electrical engineering, we use AI with different role, sometime in control. So since people are there from different background, I am not going in depth. I hope that so whatever I am explaining so far, it is well reserved or well received from the participant side. So am I correct?
Yes, sorry, sir.
Okay. So do you have any difficulties?
No, sir.
Okay. So unfortunately, I am seeing only the screen where I am showing the PPT. However, you are seeing the PPT, I am seeing the PPT. That's it. I don't have seen any participants, nothing. You see how tough it is, right? So online lecture is really very tough. We have to assume that all the audience are in front of me, then we have to speak. Suppose in a common place, if someone is noticing that I am alone speaking, they may be thinking that, oh, something happened to Kumaravel. They may not know that I'm speaking in front of 100 participants, right? That is a virtual participant. So everything become virtual today, right? So shall we go ahead? Any discomfort, whether my voice is clear, everything is all right, I hope, right?
Sir, everything all right.
No, sir, no problem, sir. Everything all right. You're okay. Audible and your screen is visible.
Well done. So madam, please inform me how long I should speak, when I should stop my lecture.
No issue, sir, you can continue.
So, madam, yesterday I want to say a small story.
Yeah, sir.
There was a great speaker. This speaker is thinking that every audience are very much interested on his speech. So what happened, one of the incident, he started lecture and he was very much interested in delivering the lecture. He was keep on going on. So in the interest, he closed his eyes for some point of time. After some time, he opened his eyes. Nobody was there in front of him. Everybody ran away. One guy was there in front of him. So his speaker was very happy. So at least everybody left out. Only one guy is there to listen my lecture. He was very happy. He approached that guy for appreciating him. And that guy told that, actually my owner sent me to collect the mic and other lights, everything. I am expecting that he will stop the lecture, but you are not stopping. Keep on talking. Okay. So, sometime as a speaker, I may be interested. If you allow me, I will speak whole day. But I do not know about participants. Okay. I hope that the given
okay,
time.
I'll ask the participants to please be interactive so that Dr. Kumaravel Sundaramurthy will be more easy to handle the session. Participants, please be interactive.
Okay. So please watch this chat box, madam, because I could not see the chat box now. So you can parallelly see the chat box. If there is any message, you can convey me.
No, as of now, there is not much messages, sir. Everybody is saying some good morning or something like that, wishing only. Not okay, questions ma'am. I'll inform you when some questions comes.
Yes. So just I have given introduction to AI. Now the time is going to be 10:20 almost. So 20 minutes almost passed away. So shall I stop at around 11:30, madam, or when I should stop? 11:30 or 12 or?
11:30.
Yeah, you can take your time, sir. We can stop at 11:30. No issues.
Okay. I know in the poster I have seen that you have arranged one more lecture.
Yeah, sir. We have one more lecture on NLP.
Maybe in the forenoon or maybe in the afternoon, madam, or?
It will be after the first session, sir. After at 11:30 we can stop, and after that the second session will start.
Okay, thank you, madam. Then I have hardly 1 hour 10 minutes, and let me go ahead further. So I hope that all of you understand what is called artificial intelligence, right? Now we are entering into artificial intelligence. So first, try to understand what is called intelligent. I have shown so many applications. I said to you that intelligence is really living with us. Artificial intelligence, you take any device today. It may be a mobile phone, or it may be a bike, car, whatever we use. Everything is filled with intelligence, artificial intelligence. So let me see what is called intelligence. So intelligence, of course, a difficult term to define, and it can mean various things to different people. So literal definition of intelligence is general mental ability to learn. So if you see from ourselves, right from childhood, we are learning. So we go to school and we learn each and everything. So we are completely in the learning process, right? We are acquiring knowledge through learning. So what we do with that knowledge, we are using that knowledge to manipulate our environment, as well as the ability to reason and have abstract thought. This is a very short definition which I have taken from literature. So very broad definition of intelligence taken from another literature. Adaptability to a new environment. Say if you see most of the devices which are not adapting itself. For example, I am telling, you are sitting under the fan. So fan is not intelligent. You all know that most of the machine, they are not intelligent. So fan is not intelligent. Even you keep at the speed of 5 or 3 or 4, anything will happen. Say it is not intelligent, no? Because you are sitting under the fan, the fan does not know what is your convenience. So suppose if the fan is intelligent, what will happen? If the fan is intelligent, if the climate is very cold, it should rotate at slower condition. If the climate is very hot, it should rotate in the high speed. Right? So fan need intelligent, right? So because environment changes. See what happened, there was a bus. In the bus, two people are traveling. Most of them are traveling and two of them are sitting. One almost elderly age, and another one medium, right? Assume that one is almost 50 years old, another one is 30 years old. They are traveling in the bus. So what happened? The elderly one is closing the window and telling the neighbor that you don't open the window because I am having cold. If you open the window, I feel very difficult. The other younger one, no, what she is telling, you open the window because I feel very hot. Otherwise, I cannot sit inside the bus. What I will do? So it was noticed by this conductor. So conductor said that, please both of you be quiet because we are in travel. So the old lady said that, see conductor, this lady is not allowing me to close the window. Because I have severe problem, health problem. If you open the window, this wind will come inside and I will die. The other lady told that I feel very hot. I could not sit inside the bus. Because it is very hot, you have to open the window. In between these two, this conductor could not solve the problem. So meanwhile, one guy called him from last seat. This conductor went to him and he asked, "See, sir, there are two ladies. They are fighting. The elder one is telling that open the window for a long time, close the window, and the younger one is telling open the window. I do not know how to solve the problem." That guy told very politely, "Very simple matter, sir. You don't know how to solve the problem." He told, "Open the window for some time. The elder one will die. Then you close the window for some time. The younger one will go. Right? Problem solved." The conductor shocked. "Suppose if I do that, no, they will die. No, it is a criminal case. Yes, so what will happen?" This fellow told, "You don't worry, sir. I will manage, because I am the wife of the younger one and the son of the elder one." Okay. So like that, we need some intelligence. Everything, no, dealing people, no, very tough. So everybody has their own agenda, their own interest. So you cannot make a common device today. Clear? You cannot make a common device today. So one fellow need a high speed engine, another fellow need a slow speed engine. Say people desire is different. Everybody has their own desire, right? So you have to make the product according to the requirement. Otherwise you cannot survive in the market. Clear? It is trendy. I think you may understand what is called trendy. So trend is keep on changing, right? For example, 20 years back, 30 years back, we take photo using film. I do not know how many of you may know about that, because you may have not seen such a technology now. Maybe 20, 30 years back I am speaking. Someone told this film manufacturing industry that, see, in future they are going to bring a digital camera which does not require film. That time, that film manufacturing industry, they never believed it. How can you think about a technology without a film? Without a film, how can you take a photo? After some time, that became true. Digital camera came. So with the digital camera, we never take a photo with the film. No film, nothing is required. Digital camera is different. After some time, what happened? Someone told to digital camera company that they are going to invent a cell phone where they are going to keep camera. So digital camera wala never believed it, because it is very tough to keep the small camera and its circuit, the whole circuit, into a mobile phone. It is very tough. But today it happened, no? Today it happened. You take every mobile phone, not one camera. There are multiple cameras. 3-4 cameras are there in a single mobile phone. So that is called a trendy. I think you all may understand what is called a trendy. So you have to invent a technology which is required now. So now you may clearly understand what is the attraction of AI. So now we are discussing what is called intelligence. So adaptability. Adaptability. So what is adaptability? Right? Changing its face. Suppose you take a children, you take the children to railway station, or maybe a bus stand, or maybe in your home. They never mind, they always play. Right? They never mind. They are always happy, right? You see children, you take them to the bus stand or maybe railway station, everywhere they play. Suppose if you do that, what will happen? Oh, people will worry, sorrow about you, or worry about you. Oh, what happened to this guy? Right? You cannot play like children now, right? You imagine, suppose you are sitting in the bus stand or maybe in railway station or maybe in home, as like children, if you always play, what will happen? People will treat that, oh, he is a mad. Okay. So that is called adaptability, right? Children does not know what to do, when to do, that thing. They never worry at all. But as a human, we are highly adapted, right? We know how to behave. Behavior, I am telling. Adaptability. Right? So adaptability to a new environment. Or maybe changes in the current environment. Changes in the current environment. Right? So initially, we may not know how to behave. But later, we will understand. Right? That is called a reaction to the environment. Reaction to the environment. So, if you want to create anything intelligent manner, so it should have the capability of adaptability. Adaptability, right? I told a fan example. Suppose, assume that the temperature is very cold. The fan supposed to run slowly, right? So you are informing fan that you run slowly. Whenever there is a small temperature or maybe cold temperature, fan always runs in low speed. That is called adaptability. You are correcting it, right? Then the ability, next one is decision making. That is for evaluation, right? Decision making. So most of the time, we may get the choices A or B or C. So you have to select any one. It is called a decision making, right? There are 100 participants are here. Let me ask a question. Which color you like? You will never said a single answer, right? Everybody will never say a single answer. Person X will say, I like blue color. Person Y says white color. Person Z says some other color. So everybody will never say a common color. Okay. It varies from person to person, right? So you are getting a choice A, B, C. Suppose if person select B, there is a reason for that. There is a reason for that. So that is called decision making. Simply you cannot take anything. You have to make a correct decision. Decision making. So ability to comprehend complex ideas. Say, suppose you are asking a person to go to bus stand from your home. How he will guide? How you will guide him? Go to the bus stand. One blue color bus come, right? You go to the bus stand. There will be a blue color bus. You get into the bus. Directly go to bus stand. You get down there. Finished. Information is very short. Go to the bus stand, get into a blue color bus, and then after 1 hour, in fact, bus stand will come. Finished. Only 3-4 line you are informing him. Suppose if it is a machine, what he will do? You need some 500 page notes, right? So get down from my home, each and everything you have to instruct. So 5 meter. Turn right, then turn left. Like that, you should give each and every information, right? If it is not intelligent, very tough. So if it is an intelligent, short, that is called comprehensive. Comprehensive instruction is more than sufficient to convey the information. The capability for original and productive thought. I already told you in the previous slide, we are learning right from childhood. So we are acquiring knowledge. So that knowledge sometime may be original thought. It may lead to original thought. So Einstein invented E is equal to MC squared. That is a original thought. Nobody else invented. Right? E is equal to MC squared. Theory of relativity. And this E is equal to MC squared, the relation between energy and this mass. So that is E is equal to MC squared, a great philosophy, theory of relativity. So that is original, right? Sometime the knowledge level increases, they can have original thought, original information. So the ability to learn quickly. So that decides learning speed. If you take a group of people, somebody may be interested in swimming, somebody may be interested in cricket, somebody may be interested in education, but everybody have their own talent. Okay, so if you teach someone swimming, very quickly they learn. At the same time, if you ask them to learn music, very tough for them. So what you understand, one medium they are very interested, whereas in the other medium they are not interested. Okay, so ability to learn quickly, that also intelligence, right? So intelligence vary from person to person, field to field. So everybody may not be genius in every field, right? The person who may be a very good cricketer may not be good in education. Okay. And learn from experiences and even the ability to comprehend the relationship. This is really a very vast definition about intelligence. So you can look into any other thing and you can have your detailed study. So just for time being, I'm skipping this and I'm moving to further slides. So first let us see whether we are intelligent or not, right? Just for fun I'm telling. So from seeing this picture, what do you understand or what do you see in the picture? Madam, are you getting any answer in the chat box?
No, sir. No, not right now. Audience, if you have any answer, please write it in the chat box. Sharin Shahana answered as some random patterns. Dipin K answered as only shapes. Devagiri College has answered as a moving circle. I expect more answers from the audience, please.
Madam, random pattern.
Yeah, it is. Okay. So actually, what I want to convey from this slide, it is a circle or a globe. Is it a circle or a globe?
Most of the people answered as a globe.
Okay, that is in fact a right answer, but I am showing only a circle because this is a two-dimensional picture. Circle is a two-dimensional picture, globe is a three-dimensional picture. I think your computer screen or maybe a cell phone screen is only a two-dimensional picture, right? It can only show two-dimensional picture. But you are seeing this as a three-dimensional picture. How? Because you are intelligent, right? As someone pointed out, if you move your eye, it will rotate. But originally speaking, this is a two-dimensional picture. It is looking like a three-dimension, right? So that is the correct answer. So what do you see from this picture? Is it a series of boat or a bridge?
Rishad PT answered as it's a wall. Safira answered as it's a bridge. And Amrita as boat. Okay. Series of boat.
Series of boat, okay. So, see, you can understand this is an ambiguous picture. You don't have a clear answer, right? You can see first one, second one, third one, of course, it looks like a boat. Maybe fourth one, but after that, you don't have any confusion. You don't have any idea. Is it a boat or maybe a bridge? A clear understanding you don't have. The next picture really is very interesting. The question is, how many pillars are there in the picture? How many pillars? Is it three pillars or two pillars?
Two pillars. two pillars.
Two pillars, sir. Please see from bottom.
Yes.
Two or three?
From bottom, this is three.
But either two or three, sir. Only one answer only I need.
This is only one pillar. only one pillar.
Okay. Neither two nor three, only one pillar. Okay. Okay, sir. Just this and all, I am showing you how tough to process a particular image. This and all, some vague pictures, which is happening in real time, right? So what I want to convey here, as a human, you can clearly distinguish whether it is two pillars or three pillars and something like that. So a machine, if you devise a machine, it is very difficult to do analysis. So that's what I'm telling you, artificial intelligence really used in various aspects. So usually when you try to see any machine, it depends upon a processor. So I'm calling here as a traditional computer. You take a TV, there is a processor, washing machine, there is a processor. So we depends upon processor to realize this intelligence. Just I am comparing the existing computer and its challenges. So difficult to process many tasks in time. Suppose you take your computer, download something from internet, then parallelly play a video, and then do some simulation, and also type some word. So finally, what will happen? The whole computer will hang. So that is called parallel processing, right? So computer can do really parallel processing, but not 1, 2, 3, maximum 4, 5, that's it. Even it is a supercomputer, it will hang. You may have experience, right? So, but as a human, do you know how many parallel processing we are doing? Lot of parallel processing we are doing, right? See, one side our heart is beating, the other side the liver is functioning, kidney is functioning. How many units are functioning in our body? Apart from that, I'm speaking to you. You are listening to me, right? Many parallel processing we are doing in our mind. So impossible to devise an algorithm or sequence arithmetic logic operations, right? Computer can execute instructions by instructions when there is any process. Reading handwritten character, it is very tough, right? Somebody will write A as something like one form somebody it may be another form. Finally, we get lot of confusion, right? So, for example, A, here you can see this is written like this, but we always write like this, right? Every time if you see in when we are happy, we our writing style will be different. When we are not happy, writing style will be different. It is very tough, right? In emotion, we write different manner. Even I guess based on writing style, you can identify whether the person is in happy mood or maybe sorrow mood, right? Similarly, recognize words spoken by any speaker. I am really appreciating this Alexa. Whatever you ask, it is answering, no? But it means you are recognizing words. Sometimes it may be wrong. Suppose if you pronounce a particular word, its slang will be different. It will differ from region to region. We all speak English, but the way how I speak may not be same with the other one. Throughout the world you surround, you will never get a unique language. I was there in Ireland for my postdoctoral fellowship. Suddenly I was getting a call from my supervisor. He told that, Kumar, you dropped me down. I could not understand what he is conveying. Then he kept down the phone. I asked my fellow colleague, hey, my supervisor is telling that you dropped me down. What did you mean by drop me down? Usually when you say I am sitting in ground floor, he is sitting in third floor. I do not understand what he is conveying, drop me down. I was thinking why he is asking me to drop him down or something like that. Later he told that he is asking to come to his room. Then I understood, okay, in Ireland drop me down means come to room. Right, it will vary from person to person, that's what I told. So driving a car, right? That too in Indian road, we need more intelligence to drive a car, right? In city you might be noticing this. Indicator may be in the right side, the person may be turning in left side, right? We need more common sense to ride a car in our Indian road. So running like an animal or a human being, it is very tough, right? So now you all may understand what are the challenges we have in intelligence. So by considering time, I am skipping most of the things. Say, when you see the main intelligence, why as a human we are intelligent, because we have the highly intelligent module in our body called the brain. So do you think that the brain is only there in our head or maybe everywhere in the body? There are some comedy, right? This guy is having brain throughout the body, right? That is ultimately correct. I am telling you a small incident. Suppose you all are watching my lecture. Okay. Assume that suddenly there is a fire in the corner of the room. Nothing will happen. Don't worry. Just for example only I am telling. Okay. All of you are suddenly hearing my lecture in your either your computer or maybe in your mobile phone. Suddenly there is a fire in the corner of the room, what you will do? Either will listen my lecture or you will run away. Whoever it is, immediately they will run away, right? Even if Barack Obama is speaking, they never mind. Immediately they will run away, right? Whoever it may be, they never worry. Because survival is the goal of any living creature in the world. Right? So what I want to convey in this incident, you are all hearing my lecture, means you are hearing through ear and something through your eyes and your brain is processing. Okay, so suddenly you are seeing fire in the corner of the room. The moment when you see, immediately your leg run away. The signal never goes to brain and then come back to your leg. The signal suddenly goes from eyes to your leg. Right? Everything is intelligent in our body. So means the neural system is distributedly located throughout the body, like a server master concept, master slave. You all know what is called a master slave. Right? So if you see why we are intelligent, if you answer this question, definitely we can understand why you are intelligent. So you are seeing the picture now. Have you ever seen this guy? So madam, any students are there from chemistry?
I don't think so. Anybody from chemistry is here?
Okay.
Is there anybody having chemistry background? No, sir. No.
Okay. Have you ever seen this guy, madam? Any answer you find in the chat box? This guy is very popular.
Yeah, I got some answer as Albert Einstein.
Albert Einstein? Okay.
Two people have answered as Albert Einstein.
Okay. Yeah, but this guy is looking like Albert Einstein, correct? But he is not Albert Einstein. He is a great philosopher who contributed a lot in the field of electrical engineering, especially in the satellite technology. His invention made a great revolution. So whatever we use today, cell phone, internet, everything really made the basic was made by him.
Sir, Priyanka Prajapati answered as Tesla.
Tesla, okay. So such a great person he is. I told you this communication technology and the so-called modern renewable energy sources like solar photovoltaic. In fact, this guy completed PhD in the area of solar photovoltaic. Such a great person he was. Can you guess him? Any more guess? Who is he? So he in fact received a Nobel Prize. He in fact received a Nobel Prize for the invention in the field of electrical science. He received a Nobel Prize in the field related to electrical engineering. Any more guess? Madam, any more answer you get in the chat box?
Yeah, sir. Sugandhi has answered as Jason.
Edison?
No, Jason. J-A-S-O-N. Jason.
Okay. Jason. Okay. I do not know who is this Jason. Okay. Even now you could not identify who is this guy?
Nikola Tesla. Nikola. Most of the answers are Nikola Tesla.
Nikola Tesla. Okay. Okay.
Saurav Santosh answered as Nikola okay. Tesla.
Okay, when this guy become older, the guy which I show here now, this picture taken in the year 1912, almost during his PhD, award of PhD degree, he received this photo, 1912. When he old now, he become like this. Now can you guess who is
this guy? Yeah, now here we have answer as Edison.
Yeah, Edison.
Thomas Edison, oh. Sanjana Sanju answered as Edison. Okay. Suhaila as Edison.
Oh, is he Edison? So my dear participants, is he Edison? think and tell.
Anjali Renji vs Einstein.
Einstein. Okay. Okay, the final answer is Albert Einstein. He is none other than Albert Einstein. Okay. So he is also Albert Einstein. I really appreciate the people who guessed in the initial stage itself that he is Albert Einstein. I really appreciate. Madam, can you guess who are that people who guess initially itself as Albert Einstein?
Yeah, sir. It's Jamshila, Anjana Narayan, Anju Thakur, Shafna M, Hridya Jairaj.
Yeah. We have to really appreciate them. So he is none other than Albert Einstein. He received Nobel Prize for the invention of solar photovoltaic effect. In fact, if you see the history, he discovered that electricity can be generated directly from sunlight. That was his philosophy. But later, his PhD thesis was rejected because telling that it is not possible. Then he proceeded further, and then finally he proved that generation of electricity, photons, from sunlight is possible. So for that, he received a Nobel Prize. Okay. So Albert Einstein, really a great scientist. So belongs to the 20th century. Really, his inventions are really, even today people are fighting against the invention of most of the concept by Albert Einstein. The notable things are solar photovoltaic, E is equal to mc squared, theory of relativity, etc. I made some conclusion, okay. So initially, I want to confuse the participants. So that's why I said so many things. Because I want to ensure that whether you are sticking on the same answer. I don't know how many of you, the people who guessed that he is Albert Einstein, it is correct. You can compare these two pictures, right? This picture and this picture. A close relation, right? It is not 100% matching. Why? Because many people may not know Einstein through this picture. This is a rare picture. This picture is a rare picture. I told you his young age picture. It is very rare. So entire world know to Einstein, known Einstein through this picture only. In school, college, whenever you see some magazine about Einstein, they keep this white hair fellow. Okay, he is Einstein. But if you see this picture, most of the features are matching, right? His eyes, nose, right? His black hair. Such a handsome guy, right? Albert Einstein during his young age. Okay. So what I convey finally, that now you may realize what are all the things I said. Adaptability, learning, feature extraction, recognition, each and everything is called intelligence. So that's what I told in the beginning itself. Intelligence is such a tough term to define. It cannot define through a literature word. It is different meaning, different context. We use intelligence in many ways. Okay. So with that, we come to the end of first half of the lecture. We have remaining half an hour. So I will move to the application of artificial intelligence. So till now, if you have any doubt, please, you can just to interact with me.
Audience, if you have any doubt, you can directly ask or you can type in the chat box.
So, dear participants, whatever I'm explaining, is it clear to you? Are you able to follow me?
Sir, we are getting answers that they are able to follow. Yeah. Most of the people are saying yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your response. We If there is no more doubt, let me move forward. This point we are going to start the research. Say you are maybe from different background, from computer science, or maybe with a different level, masters. As madam said, there are some teachers who may do PhD and currently looking into some research problem. Please follow the lecture hereafter very closely. I will touch upon here and there about the usefulness of neural network, or maybe AI. In fact, it is not neural network. You can call it as AI, artificial intelligence. Say, multidisciplinary research can bring a miracle in any field. I told you that I was in Ireland for some time for my postdoctoral fellowship. During the incident, I remember there was a PhD defense carried out at Ireland. I was just attending the session. The candidate really done a very good work. In fact, she done a work on pricing strategy in electrical engineering. You know that electricity pricing, no, it is a very challengeable task. Electricity price, one unit is equal to 4 rupees, 5 rupees per kilowatt hour, like that, you know. Every month you may be paying electricity bill, right? So she developed a pricing strategy for electrical energy. That was her whole PhD thesis. At the end of the PhD, they have given introduction about the speaker, that candidate, that so-and-so, she completed BA Economics. I really could not believe it. That is real collaboration, right? See, the student who done BA Economics is defending PhD in electrical engineering, right? I was really wondering whether it happened in India. India, it never happened. Right? If you are an electrical engineer, throughout the life you should run there only. If you are a computer engineer, you have to run there only. If you are a doctor, you have to run there. If you are a lawyer, you have to run there. If you are a policeman, you have to run there. In India, everybody have their own clear boundary, right? We never cross the boundary. But there is no use of that. So what I want to communicate, you should have a clear collaboration. Collaboration can do a miracle. Okay. So in fact, this is the first time I remember I'm interacting with different background of people where they are not engineers. Okay. So I do not know whether you understood my lecture or not. How far it is useful, I don't know. At the end, we will ask. Say you visit some of the great academicians who really do work in AI. Lot of people are there. In fact, in IIT Bombay, there is a great professor called Professor Natraj. I went personally there to attend one of his faculty development program for the period of 1 week. So they have developed a lot of things in AI. Like that, you can visit the good lectures which are available on NBTL, right? Okay, forget about that. When you talk about the research, first one, I am taking a non-linearity. I do not know how many of you understood what is called a non-linearity, which is a hard mathematical definition. Non-linear system, linear system. Madam, could you please inform me whether they know what is called a linear system, non-linear system?
Audience, if you have any knowledge about it, you can answer in the chat box. Are you familiar with linear or non-linear system? Somebody told yes.
Okay, very good, very good. Say, when you talk about a system, you may be dealing with any system. Say, This is a system, okay? This may be anything, right? Maybe a computer, maybe a mobile phone, maybe a washing machine. The system may be anything. What is a system? Devices are arranged in a sequential manner to achieve certain task. That's it. That is a simple system. So this system receives different inputs, right? Different inputs. Let me call it as x1, x2, etc., etc., xj, xn. Different inputs. The system produces different outputs. Like this, maybe y1, y2, etc., yi and ym. So system can produce n input, it receives n input and produce m output. This is called a MIMO system. Multiple input, multiple output. So practically, if you see any system, it is a MIMO system. Say the system can be classified into two types. Any system can be classified into two types. One is called a linear system. Another one is called a non-linear system. Okay. Say most of the system in practical, it is a non-linear system. You take any system, in most of the system in practical, they are non-linear system. Okay. I am not going anything in depth. Okay. So what I am telling you, the non-linear system are really very tough to model. Suppose if I want to mathematically represent this system, so you all know y is equal to mx plus c. Y is equal to mx plus c. This is a linear equation. This is a linear equation where we write like this, whereas x and y, and it is something like this. This is a linear system. Say, for example, I have something like this. This is x and this is y. Something like this. This is a non-linear system. This is a non-linear system. Okay. Something like, for example, I'm telling y is equal to 4x squared. Okay. So this is a non-linear system. This is a non-linear system. So most of the system in practical belongs to a non-linear system. So when you try to deal with the system, it is very tough naturally. So if you approach this AI, artificial intelligence, definitely you can handle this non-linearity. So this non-linearity causes different problem into the system. I do not know next term I'm going to use stability. I do not know how many of you understood what is called stability. What is called stability? Suppose assume that you have a family, you have friends, right? So you are bringing one of your friend to your home. If you are mother will never say anything. If one of your friend is coming, okay, nothing she will say. Suppose if you have your wife or husband, what he will say? If one of your friend is visiting your home, okay, nothing they will say. Suppose four of your friends are coming to your home. They will give warning. You are not supposed to bring your parents to the home. Suppose you are bringing your entire class to your home. So what will happen? Next day you will not be in home. They will send you from your home, right? That is called stability. Everything is having a region. Okay, everything is having a region. Every system is having its own boundary to be stable. Only in the region only it can be stable. Beyond the region it will never be stable. Right? Now you understood what is called stability. Say, there are some non-linearity may be present in the system itself. So non-linearity may present in the system itself, or sometime any one of the input may makes the system to be non-linear. Any one of the input may makes the system to be non-linear. So you have to handle this nonlinear effectively. Otherwise, what will happen? The system will collapse. What will happen? System will collapse. So, there, this artificial intelligent technique is used as a very good tool to handle the nonlinearity. Right? Artificial intelligence is used as a very good tool to handle this nonlinearity. Next one, I am talking about input and output mapping. Let me take the same example as a system. You take this as a system, and the system has its parameter like A, B, C, etc. And it receives n number of inputs, and assume that it receives m number of outputs, because where m need not be equal to n. Okay, so m need not be equal to n. So here we know what is the input, we know what is output, right? We never bother about the system. We never bother about the system. That is called input and the output mapping. Suppose, assume that you need the clear function of the system, how
Hello, sir. Sir, your voice is breaking. Hello, sir. I think Dr. Kumarvel has some network issues. We hope he'll join soon. Coordinators here. The coordinators present here. Audience, please stay online. I think sir has some network issues. We'll rectify it soon. Okay.
So sorry for the interruption. I was not knowing that I am out. Okay. So now I am just seeing. I think here I am. that internet connection was lost. I didn't know that. I was continuously talking and suddenly I am getting a call from organizer. Then only I noticed that I am not in the internet. Okay, now I think all of you are hearing me, right? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it happened naturally.
No issues, sir. You can continue.
Yeah. So I was telling you that I do not know where the connectivity lost. Madam, could you please tell me where the connectivity lost?
Yes, sir. This was the last site. No, okay. The previous one, sir. The previous one.
Here?
No, no.
No, input, output.
Yeah, yeah, here itself. Here itself.
Yes. I said that how to teach this operating remote control to the grandparent, whether that story was there or...
No, no, it was not audible.
Okay, okay. Okay, anyhow, no worries. Okay, I'll move forward because we don't have time. So, when you talk about the first one, I told you how to handle a non-linear system. How to handle a non-linear system. Second one, I am talking about the parameter estimation. So it is something like a black box. Assume that you have a system with a full of black box. As I told you, you know some input, X1, X2. You have some output, Y1, Y2. Only with the help of this X1, X2, Y1, Y2, if you are able to infer what is the system, that is called parameter estimation. Suppose you have some parameter A, B, C. If it is possible, it is possible in AI. So no need of any mathematics, nothing. So naturally, if you approach mathematics, it is very tough to understand, first of all. Second one, mathematics most of the time never be correct in reality. Say, I do not know how many of you know Ohm's law. I think pre-degree you might have studied Ohm's law, V is equal to, pre-degree you all might have studied Ohm's law, V is equal to I into R. Here we write T is equal to constant. So this is called Ohm's law. Voltage is equal to current into resistance. But here we write T is equal to constant, where T is temperature. So this equation is correct only when temperature is constant. But practically, nowhere this temperature is constant. Nowhere this temperature is constant. So mathematics will never be correct in most of the real time I'm speaking, because we are assuming that temperature is constant. But every mathematical system or every mathematical equation subjected to some assumptions, approximations, etc. So whereas in AI, no need of any assumption, no need of any approximation. If you have input and output, you can easily realize. When you talk about performance prediction, even most of the AI people, they are doing research in performance prediction. Say like weather prediction, like rainfall prediction. Even you see IRCTC, there's a ticket confirmation probability, no? There also people are using AI, right? Health diagnostics, biomedical application, health diagnostics. Even different people are using AI, artificial intelligence. When you come to a system control, this is a core engineering problem. This is a core engineering problem, system control. In nutshell, I will explain. Assume that you have a fan. The old example I said, you are sitting under the fan and the fan is rotating. You are adjusting a small knob, right, in the switchboard. If you keep it in one, slowly it rotates. If you keep it in two, little bit speed. Five, very high speed. Okay, that is a system control. Say, if you want to make it as an automatic system, definitely you need a controller, right? So I do not know how many of you may understand this problem. There is a controller and there is a plant. We are taking this output and feeding back to the system. Okay, this that's how the closed loop system work. So here this controller replaced by this AI controller. Here if it is an AI controller, it can give a better performance. AI controller can give better performance. I do not know whether you can understand or not. Just for information I'm sharing. If you don't understand, leave it, no worries. Pattern classification is really another application, irrespective of domain, like engineering, medical, science. Everywhere people are using pattern recognition or pattern classification problem. Like artificial intelligence are really does not have any domain. You can apply in any field so that you can proceed your research. So here I am listing few AI techniques like artificial neural network, fuzzy logic, genetic algorithm, particle swarm optimization, simulated annealing, and colony optimization, artificial immune system, like that different AI technique I am listing. According to your application, you can select any one AI technique and you can proceed towards the research. So with this, almost I am coming to the end of the research. So when you see the summary, I have first talk about AI. I was talking about AI. So initially itself, I talk about the application. Then I talk about what is called intelligence. Then we discussed about this features of intelligence. Then we discussed what is intelligence. Then we discussed usefulness of intelligence. Then we have seen research. Aspect of AI. Then we finally listed AI tools. With this, let us conclude the lecture. So thank you all of you for your patient listening and make the session as more interactive manner. So thank you all of you. With this let me stop. I have planned in fact so many things, but we don't have time. That's what I said in the beginning itself. So within the given time of 1.5 hours, I tried my level best. So I don't say that I have conveyed everything to you. I might have conveyed very meager percentage, 0.001% about AI. Just I have introduced AI, and initially itself I told you I am from different background. So if you have free time, you can look into my website. So my website is there. You can go to my website. So you can look into my website. I have almost provided all the details. So you can look into that. And these are some of my latest publications. Just to see any possibility of collaborative research, so we can maybe proceeding further. So you can look into that. Okay, so otherwise you can go to this Google Scholar, you can find my profile. So if you have free time, please look into my profile and you can see any further possible collaboration. So thank you all of you. Thank you Devagiri College for the opportunity. So okay, if you have any question, please ask me. I will try to clarify the doubt.
Audience, we have a QA session now. If you have any questions, you can ask. You can directly ask or can chat in the chat box.
Hello ma'am, am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
Ma'am, I have a question. Sir, as you said that once you were traveling to Cochin, I guess, and you went to a hotel and had some food and they gave you a mail about their service.
Yes.
What do you think that that data which goes from you without your permission, you haven't provided them any contact? How will that data shape our future and
yes, sir.
How will these things affect us?
Yeah, this is, I will tell you how it happened. So in fact, there is a Google map. If you want to access Google map, you should have a valid email ID in your mobile phone. The moment when you enter into this Google map, I think they are sharing the registration detail to anybody, public forum. I doubt through this Google map, they might have fetched some of my database and they might have sent the mail. I think there is a, because see, whenever we install some software, there are some terms and conditions. See, if you open any terms and condition, it may be 7 page or 8 page. Do you think that you will accept the terms and condition after reading all the 7 and 8 pages? Never. I think somewhere in the terms and condition, they might have written that your information might be disclosed to any public forum. I think there is a rule, we never listen that. So just the moment if you turn on that, click that, the terms and conditions are accepted. I think, I doubt that from that only they have taken my database. Okay.
Sir, actually I'm talking about that, that database they have accessed could be used to reshape our future in any kind. It could be dangerous to us. It could be like more brighter future. So how do you think that AI gonna change our future? Is it gonna make our future really good or?
You can bring AI here if your mobile phone is smart enough. Suppose if you have some kind of packages, it can assess what is the genuinity of the people who access our data. If they are genuine, if they are something like some customer, if they are genuine manner, that they can use, I guess. Some AI definitely can be used in such applications, especially to handle data.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Hi, sir.
Sir, we have one more question here in the chat box. Jisha asked us, can you give an application of AI in the field of electrical engineering?
In AI, especially in the field of electrical engineering, every electrical system has a controller. Say we are trying to improve the performance of any system. For example, assume a satellite launching mechanism. There, the target is very clear. So you should have a very sophisticated controller to reach your target. Suppose if you are not reaching the target, the whole mission is zero. So here the cost is never bothered, the system size is never bothered, the accuracy is most bothered. In such application, the controllers belongs to artificial intelligence, definitely help us to improve the performance of the system. Okay, so in electrical engineering, especially most of the time, we are talking about replacing conventional controllers by AI controllers. AI controllers. So, extremely, I'm very sorry, that is a depth topic. In fact, I have published recently a paper in IEEE Transaction on Energy Conversion, where I have designed a fuzzy controller to improve the performance of a virtual synchronous machine. If you are capable to understand the technology, you can download it from my website and you can have a vast study. So by considering the timing, I am not explaining that in detail. I hope you get the answer.
Sir, excuse me. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, madam.
Sir, please, can you send the link to your profile if it is possible?
I will share the link to organizer. They will share you, madam. I don't have your email ID. I will share my detail to the
sir,
organizer.
Can you share in the chat window?
Hello, sir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah. So myself, Lijin. I am an IT professional over here. So I am curious to know the application of AI being vastly applied in almost every field right now, from machinery to and every other part. So I am curious how the coming up generations are, or how should we prepare ourselves in a career perspective for going into a IT AI powered working environment. Like most of the blue collar jobs, along with and also when it comes to white collar jobs like doctors, also they are being heavily using Watson kind of AI in their day to day being. So how we should see our career molding in aligned with this AI being applied in every field right now.
See, today online platform really is a very good tool. In fact, we never think about this online. Maybe before the pandemic situation of COVID, one major outcome from this COVID is this online lecture. We never believed that this online lecture could brought to such a great successful situation. Today, even most of the parents, teachers, they are in the compulsion to move to online. So in fact, we also deliver lectures through online. So another advantage is you can hear very good lecture of AI anywhere from the world. So just you type in Google. In fact, there is a forum called IEEE, International Electrical and Electronics Engineering Association, IEEE. Every week, in fact, they are arranging a lecture from AI. So if you keep on watching such reputed articles and lectures, you can know what is the use of AI and other things. So am I audible, madam?
Yes, sir. Yeah, okay. Of course.
Yeah. Okay. Say, so you can hear those lecture. Second one, there are universities, they are offering certified courses. In fact, in India, there is an opportunity called SWEM courses. I think it is exactly correct. Let me check it. This is the detail. SWAYM NPTEL. So here you can search this in the website. I'm just providing the detail. SWAYM NPTEL. If you search in the Google for artificial intelligence, I think you can find some online courses which will be handled by a reputed person. Here you can see that there is a lecture, Introduction to AI by Professor Mausam from IIT Delhi. This is something like a 12-week course. This and all really a good type of outcome from pandemic situation. If you have a certified course from such a website, definitely any industry will recognize you. It will be helpful for your placement. I think I have answered your question, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sir, thank you so much. Your presentation was very well organized.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your good feedback.
Thank you, sir.
In fact, I was having some fear in my mind the first time I am going to address a different type of people who are not from my background. we have to really thank the organizer for providing, keeping confident on me. Thank you, madam, for providing such a confident on me.
No, sir. Actually, I liked your presentation and your way of presenting very much. That's why I asked for the link of your website also.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Feedback. Yes.
Any more questions from the audience?
In fact, there is a transaction in electrical. This you can see. Here somebody is asking about this one IEEE transaction on here. Yeah. This is a journal, so you can look into this journal. Somebody would like to know what are the research topics on artificial intelligence. Please try to read this journal regularly. You will get lot of research topics on this AI. Okay, so you can look into this website. Okay, so you will get lot of latest trend research topics on this AI, IEEE transactions on artificial AI. So I think a person is asking about the suggest good books for studying AI. In fact, there is no standard textbook. You can look into that, because usually I have my own experience and my own course of material to teach to my students. I never stick on a particular book. Sorry for that. Yeah. So I hope almost we have crossed the time. Thank you to all of you. So here let me say goodbye. Thank you all of you. Let us see again, because the world is a circle. We will meet here and there. So thank you, madam. Thank you for your opportunity. Thank you all of you.
Yeah, sir. Well, with that we come to the end of the session one. And it was really an interesting and informative session. And I hope the audience also enjoyed it well. The Department of CS, St. Joseph's College, Devagiri, is really grateful to Dr. Kumaravel Sundramurthy for sparing his time to share the light of his knowledge to us. I, on behalf of the Department of CS, express my deepfelt gratitude towards him. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for a wonderful talk. Have a nice day.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. See you, all of you. Bye.
Over to Jyoti, ma'am.
Okay. Next session will be starting after a short break. It will be at 12 o'clock and will extend up to 1:30. Thank you.
Good afternoon all. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
The second session is going to start. The second session will be led by Dr. Vishal Goyal, Professor, Department of Computer Science, Punjabi University. Dr. Vishal Goyal is one of the known computer science professionals in India. He is from Punjab and has over 20 years of experience in teaching and research field. His main area of interest is natural language processing, artificial intelligence, data analysis, data science, and machine learning. He has received many awards, including Young Scientist Award in 2005 and Punjab State Award in 2019. He developed a plagiarism tool named ShodhMapper. I'm inviting Dr. Vishal Goyal to this webinar. Please welcome, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And thank you for the nice introduction. I hope I'm audible properly.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I would like this session to be a very interactive session. So in which I would like to interact with all the participants along with my session, not just delivering my talk. So okay. I think that is comfortable for all.
Yes, sir. Participants?
So let me share my screen first, right? So is my screen visible to all?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So very good afternoon to all of you. And I think that is a bit sleepy moment to, for you also as the afternoon has started. Am I right? Anyhow, I'll try to make it an interesting one so that you all wake up and you are indulged into this research topic. I have attended the first session as well. Most of the session I have attended, and it was a wonderful session by the professor from NIT Calicut, and wonderful explanation about artificial intelligence, neural network, and other applications of artificial intelligence. So my topic will be entirely different, and you will be finding some research topics out of it. So those who are pursuing the research or want to pursue the research, or they want to start or finding the new topics that you people can pursue your research. So definitely you can find out from my presentation today. So as in the brochure, it has been mentioned that I'll be talking about NLP. So basically I'll be talking about a step a bit higher. I will not be talking the general terms related to NLP and the introduction about NLP, because those who are aware about NLP, no doubt I can just give the definition of NLP. I'll be talking about one of the project that we have already completed, and it was funded by the ministry to us. This is a pleasant detection tool that is primarily focused for Indian languages, and we have worked for Hindi and Punjabi. I'll be talking about the architecture, what we have developed, what are the modules of that, and what are the requirements. Fine. And no doubt, as the theme of this webinar or national webinar, it is related to AI. I'll just touch upon how plagiarism detection tool and AI can be used together. Fine. Okay, so now I'm just starting my session with an open discussion session, in which I would like all to participate in it, and one by one, let me know that how many of you have used plagiarism detection tool. Those who are doing research, or those who have already completed their research, or they are planning to do research, they are writing research paper. So definitely everybody have used the plagiarism detection tool. So can I know that which tool have you used till date?
Sir, Turnitin is a good tool.
Oh, that's wonderful. Turnitin is a good one. Anybody else who has used?
Orkun, sir.
Spokun, that's right. That is given by the UGC. Anyone else who has used it? Other than Turnitin and Urkund, any other tool anybody has used? So I think most of you must have used either Turnitin or this Urkund. So now I would like to know that how many, Quest text has been used by Prem Sankar. Okay, that's wonderful. So now I would like to know that for which language your document was written when you have used Turnitin or Quest text or Urkund. Was it in only in English language, or you have used your own regional language or other language as well embedded into your document? Only English or any regional language documents have also been tested on these tools?
English only.
English only. Anyone else who have used the tool for regional language or any other tool? Okay, fine. Another question is, most of the participants are from the IT background or engineering background, I'll say, or they are mix of like languages, humanities, arts, and commerce, and IT. Or only IT is there? Participants are from the IT background only.
Participants, anybody from other background?
Yeah, you may write in the chat box. I'm just looking at the chat box as well. So are you anybody who is from other than IT background or engineering background? Okay, so we are thinking that most of you are from the IT background only. Fine. Okay. So now I am going back to my presentation. So the topic of my presentation is plagiarism detection tool for Indian language documents with special focus on Punjabi and Hindi documents. Fine. So as the name of the topic reveals, that we are going to discuss about plagiarism detection tool that works for, or that has been designed for, finding the plagiarism for Indian language documents. Means that if your document consists of matter that has been typed in Indian languages, official Indian languages, and this software that I'm going to discuss, this basically is primarily working only on Punjabi and Hindi presently, but this can be extendable for all the other official Indian languages as well. So this is the administrative approval for my project from the MeitY. So MeitY is Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, that is Government of India Ministry. We have been provided 20 lakh rupees. I am really thankful to the Ministry for having the faith on us and providing this project to us and funding to us. Dr. Rajiv Puri, who is Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science, TAV College, Jalandhar. He was my principal investigator in this project. So look at this news, in which you can see that soon plagiarism software to check theses in Punjabi. This was the news published by the Tribune, one of the leading newspapers of India, in which it has been mentioned that now the plagiarism software will be a reality for Punjabi as well. Why they have published this news? Because you have used Turnitin, you have used Urkund. So these do not basically properly work for Indian languages. So why, we will be coming later, so why, and what is the basic purpose of this news also, that is basically mentioned in the very last paragraph of this that we have digitized the Punjabi language theses that are present on the shelves of one of the leading academy that deals with the Punjabi language, that is Punjabi Sahitya Academy. It is in Ludhiana, Punjab, where most of the Punjabi language theses are placed on the shelves. And when they are not digitized and they are not the part of the repository of any of the plagiarism detection tool, how the comparison would be done with these documents? So they are not taken into consideration. So similarly, if you can correlate with your own regional languages, so maximum old theses where the reference is being taken generally, they are not the part of the repository of Urkun, Turnitin or any other software. Even on the Google, it is not available. So then how can you expect that the plagiarism will be caught? So this is the major drawback of present, you know, plagiarism detection tools. This is the news telecast by some newspaper, published by the newspaper, in which it has been mentioned what kind of, plagiarism, if you are doing plagiarism, what kind of penalty has to be imposed on you. So let me show you the English version that is published by the Times of India. It's from the Kolkata itself. So here you can see that instituting integrity, that levels of plagiarism and penalties. Level zero, similarities up to 10%, minor similarities are no penalty. Similarities above 10 and 40%, the researcher will be asked to submit the revised script within a stipulated time period, not exceeding 6 months. Level two, similarities above 40% to 60%, the students shall be debarred from submitting a revised script for a period of 1 year. And level three, similarities above 60%, registration for the program shall be cancelled. And even there is a penalty for the guide as well. So we all need to be taken care of that. So this is the regulation that has been earmarked by the UGC. Once upon a time, Turnitin was thought to be the official plagiarism detection tool, like, you know, Urkund is there right now. But don't know what is the reason that has happened at the background. But now again, U-turn has been taken and Urkund has again become the official plagiarism detection tool that has been given by the UGC. So this is very interesting news, in which you can see that in the middle of the news, you can see language departments should devise mechanism. Why they have written it? Just we read out. For subjects of Hindi, Punjabi and Sanskrit and Urdu, where Turnitin originality report system does not function, right? It means it is not working for these languages. These departments should devise their own mechanisms to check the plagiarism. So said the amendment in the PhD guidelines on Tuesday. So it means the Punjab University, Chandigarh, one of the pioneer universities, they have realized that even the Turnitin is not working for the languages, humanities like Hindi, Punjabi, Sanskrit and Urdu. So then the departments itself has to devise the mechanism for finding the plagiarism and giving the report or undertaking for this. So this is, drawback of the existing systems. Coming to the formal definition of the plagiarism. So plagiarism is defined as the unauthorized use of imitation, reproduction of the work originally done by someone else, and thereby presenting it as one's own and original work. The plagiarism has been around since the human beings started documenting their research and literary works. We all know about it. And various degrees of plagiarism include and are not limited to word-to-word copy, copying the ideas, failing to put the quotation statements in the quotation marks, failing to provide a link to the original author, and changing the words while keeping the meaning same without giving due credits to the original author. So these are the simple things that we all know, that when we are copying word to word, right, we are copying the ideas, we are not putting the quotation statements right when we are quoting someone. So you are not quoting that statement and you are not mentioning that who has given this statement. You are not providing the link to the original author. So you are writing the synonyms, you are paraphrasing it. So all comes under. So let's have a, we see the description, copy and paste. We all know that picking the sentences or phrasing or paragraphs from the original work done by oneself or someone else and not giving any reference or due credit to the original author. Word switch. Picking the sentences or phrases or paragraphs from the original work done by oneself or someone else and making a few changes in the words. This is important, that making a few changes in the words by writing alternative words, or we can say synonyms, to hide the originality and not giving due credits to the author. Idea theft, picking the idea from someone else's work without giving a due credit to the original source of idea. That is also plagiarism. Missing citations, similar to the idea theft, where someone copies the text from someone else's research finding and fails to give a citation to the original author. That is very bad. So if we are referring someone else's work, just give due credits to that person given to the reference. What's the harm in it, right? And if you are not referencing, it means you have something going on in your mind and you are not writing it, right? Invalid citations, author giving fake or invalid references related to his or her research work. Again, something bad is going in your mind. That's why you are writing fake or invalid references, so that the original reference is not traced back. Self-plagiarism, copying one's own work and present it as something new without giving any reference to the previous work. That is bad. Dual submission. Submitting the same work to two or more journals. Translation. Author translates the original work done by someone else into some other language and presents as his own work without giving a reference to the original author. And this type of plagiarism is very hard to detect even when you are developing a software too. Why people plagiarize? No doubt they have the pressure on their minds to publish. They have the competition where either at the parental level or the colleague pressure is there. Fear of failure is there. Lack of enforcement is there. Laziness is there. And lack of knowledge is there. So I hope I am right why people plagiarize. And we all know how papers are made these days, because we are in hurry to make the new papers and getting marks into the API scores and so on. So we are sitting in front of the computers and just finding out the papers that are relevant to us and how can we make easy to make a new paper out of it. We used to sit on the computers and do the things right away. Various online plagiarism detection tools are available, like Check for Plagiarism, Drillbit software, Unicheck, Wiper, plagiarism.org, Turnitin.org, Authenticate, Plagiarism Checker, and so on. Many new are there, but the question arises, are they free or paid? First question that comes to our mind. And now if we compare with Urkund and Turnitin, Turnitin is very costly. And Urkund is given free to many of the institutions, many of the universities by the UGC. So question again comes, are they safe? This is a big question over here. Why? When you do not have any access to any of the plagiarism detection tool, what do? You need to check the plagiarism before submission, either some showing to your guide or submitting to the journal. What do? You simply go to the website, go to the Google and find any damn plagiarism detection tool, submit your work over there, so that they can process your document over there and they can tell you where the plagiarism is there or what is the percentage of your plagiarism in that paper. But what are you doing? You are giving your work to that server, to that company. We can't sure, they are saying that we do not keep the document with us. It will be deleted instantly. It will be deleted within 24 hours. How can you get the surety about that? If it is there, how can you follow them up? How can you complain against them? Right? So you should be very careful about that. People may steal your original work and sell it to other by just doing the paraphrasing, replacing with the synonyms, doing the translation of it, right? So word switching they can do, and then they can sell out to anyone. And your work sometimes may be in trouble. Even they publish it before you, and then your work comes under plagiarism. That this is your, this work, your work is a plagiarized work of that person. How can you claim that? So you should be very careful when you are choosing the plagiarism detection tool for finding the plagiarism in your work before its, you know, submission to any good journal. And even when you are submitting any paper to any non-standard journal, fine. So if it is rejected or it is taking sometimes very long time, so even that is very, you know, dangerous. But that is not in our hands, and that can also not be avoided. But that is also not sure. That is also very prevalent these days, that people are using that document and stealing your idea and publishing the works in other journals similar to that. So it's very difficult, and we need to be very careful when we are choosing the journal for the publication of our work. We have a number of open source journals. We have many commercial products, right? So we can say in open source, we have seen that Unicheck is there, Viper is there, plagiarism.org is there, Plagiarism Checker is there, Quitext is there. If you talk about the commercial products, we can see Turnitin is there, Authenticate is there, Urkund is there, Check for Plagiarism and Drillbit software are also there. And now I have just yesterday done this exercise to find out, because your theme, it was based on artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence based plagiarism detection tools, I was trying to find, and I was able to Google it, and I found that properly quickly checker are there. Yes, anybody want to ask something? Okay. Copy Leak and Duplicate Checker. So they are used AI based techniques for the development of their plagiarism detection tools. So how can we reduce the plagiarism? First is plagiarism prevention. Universities to publish the information regarding the research ethics. That is more important, right? How can that be done? Conduct the workshops time to time for creating the awareness against the evil of plagiarism. Plagiarism prevention methods have a deeper impact in the long run and may assist the researchers to get rid of this social evil in future. So as these days, you know, the corona pandemic is going on, COVID pandemic is going on. So again, we say that prevention is better than cure, right? So similarly, we are saying that for plagiarism also, the awareness is more important. So a lot of workshops should be conducted by the institutions, universities, and the information to be displayed on the websites about the research ethics. And you all may be aware of that. In 2019, the UGC has sent a circular to all the universities and the institutions that one subject has to be introduced in the MPhil coursework and the PhD coursework with the title Research and Publication Ethics, and in which they have drafted the syllabus as well. That is very good syllabus, and it is my pleasure to let you know that we have published the book on research and publication ethics title. This is published by the Deep Publishers from New Delhi, and I think next week it will come into the market. And it is based on totally the syllabus that has been governed by the UGC only. So then is plagiarism detection. Plagiarism detection techniques are based on the comparing two or more documents on a variety of parameters using one or more available techniques. So we know that when we are talking about plagiarism detection, know that whatever the document we have submitted to the plagiarism detection tool, we will be having one repository against which the document will be compared, right? So these techniques are classified using parameters such as complexity of methods used, type of tool used, type of corpus. So this is very important. Type of corpus, the repository with which your document is being compared. Fine. So if your document, if your repository is not good, then the plagiarism cannot be found, right? And the scope of similarity assessments to be done. Then plagiarism detection versus plagiarism prevention. So plagiarism prevention methods generally require more time to implement, but has a longer impact. Means awareness campaign, making a mindset of the researchers for writing a research paper in such a way that you should not do such, wrong. You should not follow wrong ethics. Fine. Plagiarism detection tools, it's require lesser time. You are submitting the document and you are getting the results out of it, but the gains are short term. So very small survey I have taken from the internet, that some of the tools that has been listed at the top: Turnitin, Eve2, Copycat, Gold, WordChecker, Glant, Moz, JPLAG, Google, Yahoo, AltaVista. So, and some of the parameters they have taken, like type of the text tool operates on, type of the corpus tool operates on, other attributes and so on. So on the basis of that, they have mentioned as a metrics that which parameters are supported by which detection tool. But as per our observation and analysis, in fact, none of these tools have been designed for the Indian languages. A sample run of Turnitin is shown in the next slide or in the coming slides, in which you will see that broken or unrecognized text is there. So when we talk about the applications detecting plagiarism in student reports or assignments, research papers submitted to the conferences or journals, doctoral theses, magazine articles, and similarity detection in writing styles of two authors, news contents, ancient literatures, and medical diagnoses. So these are the applications of the plagiarism, and we all know that how, and these are the required ones where we need to apply the plagiarism detection tools. In the previous times, there was no plagiarism detection tools automatic, so manual plagiarism detection was to be done, and it required substantial efforts and excellent memory. And computer assisted detection allows vast collection of documents to be matched with each other. So we can apply AI algorithms or very, efficient algorithms that can do the matching, right, very fast. So we know that it is a serious problem for the researchers, that plagiarism, as discussed above, is a serious problem for the researchers. There are number of efficient plagiarism detection tools available for English language, but to the best of our knowledge, not much work has been done for the Asian languages, and especially for Punjabi and Hindi language. So there should be a special software for plagiarism detection in these languages with the following features: detect the character set used in Punjabi Hindi text and convert it in Unicode format. Okay, so let's elaborate the first point over here. Okay, I'm coming to back to the audience, that how many of you know about non-Unicode fonts? Anybody who can let me know about non-Unicode fonts? Anyone? Okay, starting with the font, what we mean by font? Anyone who can let me know what is font? Among audience, can we interact? What is font?
Participants, you can directly unmute, or you can type text in the chat box.
I hope you most know about fonts. Okay, how many of you have used fonts while typing, sir, while using MS Word?
That is Chitra Devi, that is, it's a style of a text.
Very and right,
style of a text. Yes, font is a style.
Right. So
Unicode font means it's a script.
Right, style of a text. Sandeep Kashyap is there. So can you name few fonts that you have used in MS Word? Yeah, Mr. Kapil Dev Goyal wants to say something.
The Arial Times New Roman.
Yes, very right. So these are the fonts. Fine. Anybody who have used fonts for typing in their own regional language, like Hindi, Punjabi, Uriya, Telugu, anyone?
So Punjabi mein safari kuch hota hai, pata nahi.
Asis font in Punjabi.
Asis is there. Gurmukhi is there. Gurmukhi is there. Asis is there. Very right. So other than Punjabi and Hindi, anybody who have used Anmol is there, Amar Boli is there, very right. Any more fonts, can you just let me know you people have used for writing in your own regional language?
Yes, sir.
Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam.
Yeah, Malayalam. ML Kartiga. Kartiga is the one of the fonts, sir.
Okay. So this is non-Unicode font? Yeah, Mr. Prince Joy, is it non-Unicode font?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So how many of you know about non-Unicode and Unicode? What is the difference between Unicode and non-Unicode? That is very important to understand. So someone has written Ravi. Okay, yeah, Dr. Harjeet Singh has written Ravi, so right. So, okay, let me explain you about Unicode and non-Unicode font first. See, when in the older times, as Mr. Kapil Dev Goyal has written Kruti Dev in Hindi, right, and Asis in Punjabi. So, what are these? These are non-Unicode fonts, right? Non-Unicode means that suppose you have some document in Samoz Malayalam and you get it typed in font that has been mentioned by Mr. Prince Joy. You taken that document after typing in the pen drive and came back to your home and you try to read it, putting the pen drive in your own system that is available in your home, at your home. But you are not able to open it. It looks like a junk. Why it looks like a junk? Because the font that has been used for typing in by the typist, that font is not installed in your system that is present at your home. It means if you want to read that font proper, your document properly, you need to have that font on your system. You need to install that font on your system. But with the advancement of the technology, this drawback has been removed and now the Unicode is there for typing. Unicode means universal encoding. It is not a font, but it is an encoding, universal encoding, right? So this universal encoding supports all the languages, right? So as it has been mentioned that Ravi is there, right? Ravi is Kruti Dev Unicode font for Punjabi, right? If you talk about Mangal, this is the Unicode font for Hindi. So if you have your document typed in Ravi, so if you take that document anywhere and open it any system that have Windows XP and above, you need not to have any extra font installed on your system. You will be able to read the document just putting the pen drive and opening it. You need not to have the extra font. So this is the beauty of the Unicode. So similarly, for each language, you are having one Unicode font. So now, why there we require detect the character set used in Punjabi or Hindi text and convert into Unicode format? Because as we have diversity of Punjabi fonts, diversity of Hindi fonts, right? So you cannot make your software develop for each and every font. So the input to my system is always Unicode format font only, right? So we need to understand which character set, which font has been used for typing in the document and first convert into Unicode and then process it. So then this is the first objective was our project that detect the character set used in the Punjabi or Hindi text and then converting into the Unicode format. Second was remove stop words from the text before plagiarism detection. What do you mean by that? When you are processing an input document, in that input document, some words are there that should not be considered as plagiarism. Like if I talk about Hindi, ka, ke, ki, hai, hi. If you talk about English, is, are, am, the, right? So they should not be considered while we are calculating the plagiarism. So we are considering these as the stop words and we will remove them before the processing of the document. Then detecting the copy paste plagiarism. So algorithms will be used for finding the copy paste among with the repository documents. Then we are detecting the plagiarism based on the syntax and semantics of the language. We are detecting the word speech plagiarism. We are considering the synonyms if it has been used over there, taking someone else's document. And we are considering very short matches and long matches will be, short matches will be ignored and long matches will be taken into the consideration. So we have seen that there are very less tools that work for Asian languages and rather we can say they do not work. So that's why this project has been taken. So this was the basically aim and the objective. First is investigate the NLP technique for the plagiarism detection. Use plagiarism detection techniques for detecting plagiarism in Punjabi and Hindi. So first module is detecting the character set or fonts used in input document and code them into the Unicode format. So font converter has been developed. Fine. Font converter means if Krutidev, if document has been typed in Krutidev, we are inputting that document to this module. It will give me as output the document that has been encoded into the Unicode format. So then standardized platform has been provided for the processing of the document. Then we are having the module that will remove all the stop words from the text, right, before the plagiarism detection is being done. Then we are normalizing the text using the stammer and the lemmatizer. Then we are finding, we have implemented so many algorithms for finding the plagiarism based on copy paste, syntax and semantics, word switch plagiarism and synonym use. Very short matches we are ignoring and the long matches we are taking into consideration. And this is the beauty. Last point is the very important and very, this is the beauty of our project, that software design that can be extended to other language sets. That is very important. So because we have presently worked our system for work for Hindi and Punjabi. So if someone can give me the language resources for their own regional language, so this system will start working for other regional languages as well. So very less programming or modification will be required in our architecture. So what are the identified challenges? Because there is a diversity of Hindi and Punjabi fonts in the input documents and let me understand you that when I am talking about diversity in Punjabi Hindi fonts, we have collected approximately 150 Punjabi and 150 Hindi fonts. And this is very, very difficult task to collect 150 fonts and then prepare the test document corresponding to those 150 fonts and then testing on and making the mapping for them. And second was the really major task and major challenge for us, that lack of Punjabi Hindi literature or source documents or online literature. As I have already discussed that the books or theses, they are available in the libraries in the form of hard books. But when we are talking about software, we require the digitized version of that. And digital version of these things are not available and we need to make the provision for that. Then selection of suitable discriminators reflect the plagiarism and not the coincidental similarity. Efficient Punjabi Hindi stammer, even stammers and lapidizers are not available till date properly. So we need to modify it if available or we have to make our own. Ambiguities in the language has to be considered and into the incorporated into the, our software. So this is the snapshot of the Turnitin. Whosoever used, they can just see this is the software that you have used. This is one of the document we had submitted to the Turnitin. That was the Punjabi document. And this is the report that has been generated. It says that 72% similarity index is there. But when you look at the results, whatever the document it has extracted, you will be surprised to see that Punjabi document has been extracted like this. So if you are not able to understand Punjabi, so I will let you know that it's all junk. not even single word is proper. So if the extraction of the text, reading of the document is not proper by the Turnitin for Hindi document or Punjabi document, how can you expect that the results for the plesm will be correct? This is the snapshot of the Ithenticate, right? And then this is the snapshot of the Urkund. You, most of you have used it. This is the snapshot of our own project that we have developed, that the name of that is Shodh Mapak, right? I'll show the demo of that. Now I'll be showing you a few of the slides that will be comparing the results of the Urkund along with our Shodh Mapak. So this is giving the result of 0% when we have submitted it Punjabi document. And this is what it has extracted from the Punjabi document. So you can see, if it is not able to extract the text out of it, then it will not be able to find the, you know, plesm as well. So it is giving another document we have given to it. It is giving 0%, fine. And no doubt it has extracted bit fine, but results, again, they are wrong. It is zero. It is giving 9% of plesm in another Punjabi document. And this is what it has extracted. It is all junk, right? So now we have started case studies, displaying of case studies in which we have taken some matter from the internet and we have copied from the thesis. So Urkund is giving 0% results and our Shodh Mapak is giving 32% result. Another, we have taken thesis, chapter and internet. So it is giving 0% and Shodh Mapak, our system has given 55%. Another, we have submitted Punjabi document, it is giving 0%, it is giving 89%. Again, it is giving 0% for another document and the same document submitted to the Shodh Mapak giving 88%. Then here it is Punjabi paraphrased text. So we have paraphrased something, right? The document was submitted to Urkund, it gives 0%, but Shodh Mapak is able to find the paraphrased text as well and it comes out to be 42%. Then we have taken two, three theses from the Shodh Mapak itself, and we have mixed the content of those theses into the PDF file and generated the PDF file submitted to Urkund. It gives 0% and Shodh Mapak gives the results of 57%. Then we have taken the direct document from the Shodh Ganga. Urkund gives 1%, Shodh Mapak gives 100%. So this is how the results for the Urkund looks like, and this is how the results looks like for the Shodh Mapak, our system. Urkund is 0% and Shodh Mapak is 35%. And this is how the Urkund results looks like for the Hindi document. Because it works for Hindi and Punjabi, so I'm showing you the Hindi as well as Punjabi. So this is all about Shodh Mapak, that is giving 99% for Punjabi. This is the, we have taken the documents from the scanned images as well. Yeah, so I have shown you the difference of the working of the Urkund along with the, because I don't have the much, access to the Turnitin, and no doubt the results will be the similar kind of thing. Now, what are the project phases? First is document repository building, input document pre-processing, document preparation, document comparison, evaluation, and deployment. The beauty of the software is that it is a generic architecture for the Indian languages, right? So no doubt we are presently work for Punjabi and Hindi only, but our system software architecture is like that it will work for all the Indian languages, and we need to make very fewer changes for programming. This is the architecture that I will explain you that how the system works. You can see the middle component of this, right, in which I have written language independent. So this is the programming part. And you can see on the right side, there is a language dependent part in which you need to provide the language resources. So no doubt we have the Hindi and Punjabi language resources with us, but we do not need to have the, if you want the system to work for your own language, so you need to provide these documents and this system will be ready for that language as well. So first component you can see over here is pre-processing, in which the input to this module is query document. Query document means whatever the input document we are going to provide for plesm detection. We are doing the Unicode conversion first of all, right? So if it is in non-Unicode, it will be converted to Unicode. After it is converting into Unicode, we are removing the stop words out of that because they do not have the relevance when we are finding the plesm. Then we are doing the stemming and lemmatization. When we have done the stemming and lemmatization, our document is now ready, pre-processed, and we are preparing the documents for further processing. We are replacing the synonyms, that is synonym replacement. Then we have the part of speech tagging. Then we have the document indexing. So this is all about the document preparation. So if you look at the pre-processing part, stemming and lemmatization, it requires stemming rules. For Hindi, we have a separate stemming rules. For Punjabi, we have stemming rules. And if suppose we want this to be this to work for the Malayalam, so you need to provide the stemming rules for the Malayalam language. If you talk about the Unicode conversion, you can see here we have a character mapping, right? That is used for Unicode mapping conversion. Stop word removal. So we need to have the collection of stop words. And when you talk about stemming and lemmatization, we require two things. One is the unigrams, and another we require the named entities. And when we talk about the document preparation, we have the synonym replacement in which we require dictionary or the word net. We're part of speech tagging, we require the annotated corpora. When we talk about the document indexing, we require keyword document pair. And here we have the document comparison part in which we are building n-grams and calculating the n-gram frequency and n-gram comparison and calculating similarities. So for this, we require the document repository. And even if you look at the right-hand side, we have a cloud sort of thing in which we are using the internet or online documents as well for the comparison person. So we are having the offline repository along with we are using the online repository for comparing the document. And this is again the beauty of our software, that we are using the open source platform, right? So you can just, when you go back to your PCs after this webinar, you can just search out Tesseract. Tesseract is very good OCR, open source software, right? Open source, this software is there. That is Tesseract, OCR is there. So we have, and why we have used, because it is having the support for Hindi and Punjabi also. There was a problem of Sihari, but we have removed it, and it is, you know, we have removed it, and it is working for Sihari problem, corrected version as well. And Apache Solr, document archival and indexer. In India, I think very less people will be using this Apache Solr. So you can just find out, this is the very best system to use when you are talking about document archiving and indexing. We are using Twitter Bootstrap, we are using PHP Python, and we are using JSON. So all are open source technologies. When we have to develop the repository, we have used internet for crawling the web, putting into the repository. We have used Google APIs as well for searching the results from the Google search engine. Digitization of the printed journals, like we have done OCR of many printed books and journals and theses. Even we have entered the data manually also for making the repository. You will really appreciate that I have starting in the beginning, I have talked about the Punjabi Sahitya Academy. In Punjabi Sahitya Academy, there were 300 theses that were placed on the shelves, and they were not coming into any repository for finding the plesm. So my student team, my research scholar team used to visit the Punjabi Sahitya Academy Ludhiana on the weekly basis. They used their own camera phones. There were no computers, though the typing was done by the typewriters, manual typewriters type of things, right? So the thesis are there that has been written as well. So there is no OCR that are accurate enough to extract the text out of these, right? So still we are developing the OCR that is capable of extracting the text from the typewriter typed text images. So still this is an open research area, and you people can also pursue this. Anybody who wants to pursue your research in your own regional language, you will find this problem still unsolved. So this is another newspaper news when we have completed the task. So this was the news in the newspaper. we accessed PhD thesis that was stored at the academy for more than 40 years. And some among us, these are burned out also. Our student visited the academy and clicked the photographs of each and every page. Later, we extracted the text from the MPEG. It's JPEG files and stored them into the PDF format. So even we have found 100 thesis projects which were not readable condition. So we have developed the website for them. This is a screenshot of the Google API we have used, in which we are providing the keywords to the Google crawler, and it is returning us the results in the form of the links. So then we crawl them and store into our data repository. Unicode conversion, that is a very good and required module, in which we are doing the font conversion for the repository documents, font conversion for the query documents. We are converting into the Unicode encoding, and the character mapping that we have used is the XML based, and Unicode modules are there for the Punjabi and Hindi. These are the screenshots for our font converter. I will be giving you the demo on this also. This first one is the Punjabi font converter, and this is the Hindi font converter. Stop word removal means that we have the stop words with us, in which before preparing the document, so stop words are removed from that. This is the module for the stop word removal for Punjabi. So you are providing some Punjabi document at the top text box, text area. Click on the process. It will remove all the stop words and give the output in the second box. So we are using stemming and lemmatizer as well. So this is the stemmer and the lemmatizer. So stemmer with NER, what do you mean by that? So anybody who know about named entities, anybody who can let me know what is named entity, anybody if know about it? Dear participants, anybody knows about named entity? Okay, I'll let you know what is named entity. Like nouns, we can say, if I talk about my name, Vishal Goyal, so this is a named entity in collection, right? If you talk about the festival names, if you talk about the name of the cities, name of the trains, name of the banks, right? So they are all the named entities, and you should not stem it because it is a name, and name cannot be stemmed out. So then it means you need to tell the system that these are the named entities, and you should not go for its stemming. So stemmer with named entity recognition means it is also taking care of that the name, if the named entity is there in the paragraph, it should not stem it. And we have done a lot of exercise on it, in which a lot of we are using rules over here, and we are applying a lot of colors over here, in which we are applying the rules, and then we are finding that what is the what has been stemmed, right? So total number of words, named entities found, exceptions found, not stemmed, correctly stemmed, incorrectly stemmed, too small to stem. So all number of parameters. If you talk about colors, so we have used brown for named entities, green for exceptions, black for no change. So no change means it is not stemmed. Pink, confirmed after stemming, so it is correctly stemmed. Stemmed but not in the dictionary, so it is too small to stem for the blue color. So in this way, the color scheme has also been used. So synonym replacement. So in synonym replacement, already the benchmarked data is already there by the TDL consortium. It is with the name WordNet. So technical name is WordNet. So there was a consortium of 17 universities made by the TDL. TDL means Technology Development for Indian Languages. That is center established by the Ministry, Government of India, for developing the language resources. So WordNet is one of the resource. So we have used Hindi and Punjabi WordNet extracted out of it. So then we have a local repository of the documents, and we have tagged it, indexed using the Solr. Automated texting and manual texting is there. So you hear keyword detection is there. So when we are asking the user to enter the document for finding the plasm, and we ask for the keywords as well, sometimes the users input the correct keywords, sometimes they do not enter. Then we are detecting the keywords by ourselves. Fine. So this is how the Solr repository looks out, looks like, and document indexing is done. This is manual repository search. This is the document comparison algorithms that we can use, like building engrams, fingerprinting engrams, calculating similarity score using comparison chosen. So in this way, this is the engram generation. So when you are inputting something, so how the engrams are generated. This is the snapshot for the my jobs when you are submitting the document and how the listing looks like. This is the plagiarism detection tool report looks like by the Shodh Mapak. It is similar to the Orkun. We have tried to make it a copy of that. So this is, you need to log in. We have the provision of approving or disapproving the users. This is how you can submit the job to our Shodh Mapak. These are the job results that are shown by the system. These are the existing tools, right? And this is the Shodh Mapak. We are using the Google crawler as well. This is, we are using the web crawler as well. And this is the, we have used the Shodh Ganga downloader as well. We have tried to download the PhD thesis from the Shodh Ganga and put into our repository. We acknowledge them. Thank you very much. Sometimes when we are, because we are getting the PDF out of Shodh Mapak or any other, so when we are using the Tesseract OCR, sometimes some error remains. So we have to find, we have to make the modules for OCR corrector as well. So we have already, we have applied for the trademark for this Shodh Mapak, and this is on the final stages, and we are hopeful that within a month we will be getting the trademark for Shodh Mapak. And when we talk about copyright, so it has already been copyrighted. So we have already talked, so this is another Punjabi Digital Library. So we are really thankful to the Punjabi Digital Library Mohali in Punjab. They have provided us 324 books in DVD, but they were the handwritten. We were not able to use it, but we are really thankful that they have trusted on it, and they have given the handwritten books to us. Even we have digitized the Punjabi University Library as well. Number of theses way back to 1960s, they were placed and they were warning out. So we have digitized them, and now it is available online as well. This is the repository detail. So you can see Hindi, we have 3,900 documents. Punjabi, we have 2,352 documents. Then Ministry has told to get the tool evaluated from three state universities. So it was evaluated from Punjabi University, Patiala, without any knowledge to us, from Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, and from Punjab University, Chandigarh. And we are really thankful to all the three universities that they have given the positive report, and they have admired that this is the good software, and but repository has to be increased. So thank you very much. And organizer, can you just let me know if you'd like to know about the Python, how we can process the language through Python? Would you like to know about the library? Yeah, organizer.
Participants.
Would you like to know about the Python library for NLP processing?
Sure, sir.
Okay, I'll give you a brief idea about that, which library is being used, right?
Okay.
So now how to work with the language data in Python 3, right? So there is a library that is Natural Language Toolkit in Python that is used for the natural language processing. So this is a collection of Python functions and objects for accomplishing the NLP task. And it do have the sample text as well for testing purposes. It is a SWT that contains libraries and programs for statistical language processing. It is one of the most powerful NLP libraries, which contains packages to make machines understand human language and reply to it with an appropriate response. It is a suite of classes for several NLP tasks. It do have the libraries for parsing, part of speech tagging, a lot of classifiers are there, and several text processing utilities. Number of corpora are also there in the NLP NLTK. It includes text material. Raw text is there, annotated text is there. If you talk about tools, there are number of part of speech taggers for number of languages. there is a semantic analysis as well. If you talk about resources, a number of word nets are there, tree banks are there. There are a number of linguistic tasks, part of speech tagging, parsing, word net, named entity recognition, information retrieval, sentiment analysis, document clustering, topic segmentation, authoring, machine translation, summarization, information extraction, spoken dialect systems, natural language generation, word sense disambiguation. So these are all open research areas. If anybody who wants to pursue their research in NLP, still these areas have a lot of scope to work on. If you talk about any your own regional language, you can work on these topics. So you can see that you can see Python minus C import NLTK. So you need to install NLT module. So you can check whether NLTK is installed or not. So you can use this Python minus C import NLTK. If it will be installed, this command will complete with no errors, and you can find out the version as well. So in Python, yes, okay. So print NLTK dot version. So here you can find out the version of the NLTK that has been installed on your system. If it is not installed, you can see the red line over here, it will give you an error. And you can install by writing this command pip installed NLTK. Then you can install the NLTK data, right? So Python minus M NLTK dot downloader Twitter underscore samples. So it will download the files or data corresponding to the Twitter underscore samples. If the command ran successfully, you should receive the following output. It is downloading, and it has been downloading and unzipping the corpora. So you need to check whether it has been installed successfully. You go to Python, from then you try to import from nltk.corpus, import Twitter underscore samples. So it will, if it is there, then you can write Twitter underscore samples dot fields, file IDs, sorry, not fields, file IDs, because number of files will be there. So then you can see it will show the number of files, like you negative underscore tweets dot JSON, positive underscore tweets dot JSON, and tweets dot some number dot JSON. So number of files will be downloaded. Then you can use some one of the file JSON file, and you can read that file and find out. So it will show number of corpus details. Then you need to install the tagger. So you can install the tagger. So here it has been shown that you can use averaged perceptron tagger. How can you do? Python minus M NLTK dot downloader averaged underscore perceptron underscore tagger. If it is successfully, it will start downloading and then unzipping. Then you have a tokenization, means you can see breaking the sentence into single word. So it is how the tokenization works. So this is how from nltk.corpus you have import the Twitter underscore samples, then Twitter underscore samples dot string converted in strings, and then you have tokenized dot tokenized. So this is how you have done tokenization, part of speech tagging. Then you have a part of speech tagger. So here you are using from nltk dot tag import pos underscore tag underscore sense. So why you are using sense over here? Because when we have multiple sentences in one go, you want to tag, so you will be underscore sense. And then you are providing what data you want to do. So it will be tagging. So here you can see it has tagged JJ adjective, NNP pronoun. Then you have determiner and so on, and then noun and so on. Then you can count the part of speech tags by using a small inner outer loops. This is a full tag starting with the, you have imported the Twitter underscore samples. Then you have imported part of speech tag underscore sense. Then you have used tokenized for tokens. Then you have provided those tokens for tagging to the part of speech tagger, that is POS tag under sense. Then you are initializing the counters, then you are putting into the tags and you are finding how many adjectives and how many nouns are there in that, right? This is about parsing. So how the parsing works over here in NLTK. So these are some of the areas of the NLP in which you can just work on, like shallow parsing, in which tokenization and part of speech tagging and forms of words are there, deep processing, word order, meaning, translation, and natural language generation is also. So thank you very much. This was all about my talk. And if you want, organizers, kind of let me know if you want to see the demo of our project. Would you like to see the demo of my project?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Let me just share me the screen. Is it visible to all?
Yes, sir.
Shodhmapak, right?
This is the
website of our Shodhmapak pleasant detection tool that we have developed. Here, I can log in from here. Only the authorized user can access it. So this is the first page, starting with the My Jobs, in which we have put on number of jobs over here. You can see this is the listing over here, in which job ID, which language document is in Punjabi or Hindi, what is the title of that job, when it was submitted, and when the job was finished. So is it finished or it is processing, and what is the result? And if I click on this percentage, you can see that the result will be displayed over here. And the format of the display of the result will be, if you have used Urkund, it will be almost similar kind of a look. So you can see this is the result of our own system Shodhmapak, in which page by page you can have the report of this. Fine. So here the download option is also there. You can download the full results over here. So the as Urkund is giving you the results, so similarly it will give you the results. So if I click on, if I uncheck some result, so the results of the percentage will also change over here, as it is being done in the Urkund as well, if something you found that it is not there. In administration also, the website can be managed by any of the administrator through this CMS kind of thing. Then similarity, we have used cosine similarity over here. So here, if we provide any text over here, so it will provide you this similarity over here. Right, so let me take one. I'm just copying from BBC Punjabi, directly from the newspaper, putting over here. So because sometimes the newspaper do not come into the results because they require indexing. And it may take time for the indexing. So this works for finding the similarity. So in this way, this system works like. And then we have the repository, right? We have the crawler, right? So here we can put the any text over here, and it will crawl from the net. It has crawled from the net. You can see. So a lot of results has come over here from the Google. Fine. And then in repository, you can see a list over here also, whatever the repository we have. So I'll show you the Hindi one. So you can see a lot of results have come over here that is present in my own repository, right? And then tools, we have lot many tools over here. We have a stammer. Stammer, if I put any stammer over, any text over here. So I choose the language, the Punjabi over here, as I put the Punjabi. So it has done the you can see over here language has been used, right? Then we have tools in which we are having the Punjabi Unicode conversion, in which if you provide non-Unicode Punjabi text, it will convert into Hindi. Here also it is for the Hindi, right? And then for stopword removal, if I have some document with me, I put over here, okay, let me choose the Punjabi over here. So it will remove the stop words from here, right? And then we have final output PDF readers. So this is also a very important point that most of the OCRs do not have the PDF readers that are capable to read the. So it took approximately 6 months to 7 months to develop this module by my senior research fellow, that is Mr. Jitesh Pubeja, who is continuing this tool as the PhD work. So he has put a lot of efforts on it. So in this way, OCR corrector is also there. Some OCR errors is there. So we are putting the document over here and it is correcting after that. So this is all about our OCR, our Shodh Mapak. So now we can have the open discussion. Over to the panel now for discussion, please.
Participants, can I ask questions? Sir, now short mark. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
Yes. Now Shodh Mapak is only focusing on Punjabi and Hindi language, right?
Yeah, presently it is working for Hindi and Punjabi, but it is an open area research area that this can be made work for other official Indian languages as well. But the programming has already been done, only the language resources are there.
So okay, this started with Malayalam, sir?
Yeah, it can work for Malayalam. So that's not an issue. Language resources need to be there.
Okay. So participants can ask.
Thank you, sir. It was very informative and fruitful session by you. It helps us a lot.
Thank you very much.
In further discussing the research.
Thank you, sir.
Now is the time for question answer session. Participants, you can ask your queries.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
As well as the thesis writing in English language is concerned, according to you, which is the good plagiarism detection tool which comes in the non-paid category?
Non-paid category. I don't think any non-paid plagiarism detection tool is there that can give you very good results. And if, if you are using directly, I have already talked to you. If you are using any web-based that is free of cost, so you cannot rely on that, because they may be claiming that we will be deleting your work, right? Or we are not storing it, but you cannot believe it, right? Like presently, we have very prominent three, like Turnitin, Authenticate, and Urkund. And Urkund is it's a Sweden-based company that has developed it. And the UGC has also approved this Urkund as the official one for detection. But I don't think so any good plagiarism detection tool is yet there, even for English, that can give you good results and that is free. And best, I think Turnitin is gear that is working perfect, not perfectly, but it's okay, fine, good other than that. Because if you talk about any journal where you can submit your paper, they will look for below 10% plagiarism results from Turnitin software only.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Any more
questions? Sir, two are asking your PPT for them. Can you share your PPT for them? Two are asking.
I will just modify, and whatever I can share, I will definitely share. Fine.
Okay, sir. Any more questions, please? I think session is very fruitful. I think we reached no more queries, I think, sir.
Oh, that's okay. Thank you very much.
So it was a wonderful session, sir. It's a very fruitful session. So we reached the end of session. I would like to thank Vishal sir for enlightening us with his knowledge. Today's webinar session was full of knowledge and interesting things, and it gave an insight to the topic and also revealed some interesting facts. The point where Vishal sir told about that is different plagiarism detection tool is needed for Indian languages was really informative. I'm pretty sure this precision knowledge of Vishal sir give us for definitely help us in our studies and future. Thank you, sir. We are really blessed with your presence. Thank you very much for your session.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir. Dear participants, we will be sending a feedback form from through email, and you can get it from the chat box too. You need to fill up it and submit. The participation certificate will be issued only after we receive the feedback form. The participant who is watching through the YouTube channel can access the link from the description box itself. So now we reach the end of our session. On behalf of Department of Computer Science, St. Joseph College, Devagiri, I'm here to give the vote of thanks for today's webinar. I would like to thank to the webinar speakers, Dr. Kumarvel sir and Dr. Vishal Goyal sir, for enlightening us with their knowledge. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting things. It gave deep insight into the topic and also revealed some interesting facts. Once again, I would like to thank Vishal sir and Kumarvel sir for taking out time for their busy schedule and enlightening us with their knowledge. Thank you so much. Next, I would like to thank our principal, Dr. Sabu K. Thomas, and manager, Dr. Father Biju Joseph, and director, Father Sunil, for all the support organizing this event. Next, I want to thank the teammates who really worked hard to make this event successful. Finally, I thank you all the participants present here for paying your attention and learning. Thank you all once again. Have a good day. You reached the end of our session, and don't forget to fill your feedback form. Thank you.